I think we'll start. All right, guys. Good evening. Thank you for coming out of hours, coming after a hard day of uni or placement. My name is Priyesh. I'm currently QuesMed's Digital Teaching Fellow. And as I've already said to some of the guys that came in earlier, I completed my foundation training last August and I'm currently taking an F3. And today we're going to be doing the first part of an 8-part lecture series, primarily for finals or UKMLA. And the first specialty that we're going to be going through today is respiratory medicine. So this is primarily going to be sort of an SBA-based lecture where we'll go through questions, go through the right answers, why certain answers are wrong, and then a bit of theory as well. The session is going to be recorded and it is going to be put on YouTube, but we won't be sharing the slides. But obviously you can look at the content on the YouTube video afterwards. It's quite a few questions and we might be a bit pressed for time. So, you know, obviously, if you have a question, please do put it in the chat with the Q&A and I'll try to get to it. But as I said, we've got quite a bit of content to get through as well. And, you know, it's the end of January now. I'm sure some of you do have your finals coming up and, you know, I hope that your preparations have been going well. And if not, you know, and you still find that there's some gaps, hopefully we can try to address those today. So don't be disheartened if you get any questions wrong. This is all, you know, it's supposed to be a learning experience anyway. So I hope you find it useful. Just to start with, I just wanted to show some of the things that we've got on QuesMed at the moment. We've recently revamped our website. And, you know, whilst I'm sure all you guys are thinking about are your finals and your exams coming up, I do also want to plug that, you know, for those of you who may have preclinical exams this year as well, we do have an anatomy and preclinical section dedicated to that. And although it may seem far away, once you guys qualify as doctors and you're starting to think about postgraduate exams, we recently started our MRCP question banks as well as our MSRA and interview question banks as well. So please do look out for those if they're relevant to you in the future. But to now go into today's topic, we are going to be going through some of the main conditions you're going to see in either on your respiratory placement or that will come up in your exam. So asthma, spirometry, COPD, ABGs, pneumonia, pneumothorax, pleural effusions, and also PEs. So this is the first question. I'm going to give about a minute or just under a minute, because that's how it will be in the exam. But if I end it a bit quickly, again, please don't be alarmed. This is just to make sure that we cover all the content. For someone asking what an SBA is, it's a single best answer. So the type of questions that often come up in the exams. We'll end it there. Yep, so the majority of you got that correct. Let's talk about a bit of asthma. So asthma, one of the main conditions you'll learn about in respiratory and that you'll come across on placement as well. It's extremely common. It's characterized by chronic inflammatory airway inflammation, and that is reversible. Which you'll see is a key difference between this condition and COPD, for example. It's a type 1 hypersensitivity reaction, so it's primarily IgE mediated, and the main constituents of it are a triad of bronchospasm, inflammation, and mucus. Triggers can vary from person to person. Sometimes it can be cold air, sometimes it can be exercise, sometimes it can be pollutants. And really importantly, it can have quite a big impact on someone's quality of life. For example, if you're in school, it can mean time off. For example, it might mean that you can't participate in PE or sport, but also employment as well. And actually, sometimes a trigger can be a workplace exposure, which you might see in the pattern of symptoms. And importantly, if it's causing issues at nighttime as well, that can impact your sleeping, which can then also impact your functioning as well, which is why it may result in time away from work, for example. And SAMHSA's tried, this is quite a niche point, but you know, It's a QuesMed lecture, so it wouldn't be QuesMed lecture without that. AERD stands for aspirin exacerbated respiratory disease. So for some people, their symptoms can be triggered by medications as well. And aspirin is one of those. So the age-old question, do I need to learn BTS or NICE guidelines? I'm reviewing a lot of QuesMed content at the moment and responding to a lot of emails, and this is probably one of the most common ones. And there's two main caveats to this, and this is what I was told when I was in medical school. So I was told, and this held true, that you would never be given a question where there's any ambiguity between either NICE or BTS. So you'll only be asked questions that, you know, there's a clear and definite answer. The second thing is that if there is a specific point to a specific guideline, that would be referenced in the question. So it might say, as per NICE guidelines, as per BTS guidelines. So I know it's a cause of stress and tension, but please be reassured, you know, question banks and your medical school is hopefully not trying to catch you out. But I appreciate, as far as I'm aware, the UKMLA content map and the latest guidance from them haven't said whether they would be aligned to either. But I would say stick to the NICE guidelines, learn the NICE guidelines. And if there's anything specific, that would be referenced in the question itself. So this is quite a busy slide, but to go over sort of the main points of the NICE guidance for asthma treatment. The main things that you need to know are that, you know, if a patient is using their reliever inhaler multiple times a day or once a week at night due to an acute flare, that's a red flag for someone who needs to have their treatment and management plan reviewed. In the acute flare, they can use their reliever inhaler for 10 puffs for 10 minutes. And the next step from that is a preventer inhaler. So sometimes we say reliever and preventer, that refers to salbutamol and inhaled corticosteroid respectively. Here's the point where it differs between NICE and BTS. So the next step is to use a leukotriene receptor antagonist like montelukast. And following that, there's then the stepwise approach of either adding a new inhaler, like a long-acting beta agonist, or increasing the dosing as well. And again, we'll see what happens when there's a flare-up, for example, but you may need to involve a respiratory clinic as well. And yeah, okay. So the next question. Okay, and the poll there. So the majority of people actually went for D, but the correct answer here is pheno testing, and we'll go on to why. So the investigation of asthma is very clearly laid out in NICE guidelines. And I think the most important here for a point in practice is that, you know, if someone's coming in and they're short of breath and they're wheezy, you're not going to skip to, you know, wanting to confirm a diagnosis. You're going to treat an exacerbation as asthma, and then you would do these kinds of tests afterwards. So, you know, the first point is that these are tests that you are likely to do in primary care when outside of an exacerbation, and again when you're trying to get a bit more information, but an exacerbation may have triggered this, for example. So the only objective tests are pheno and spirometry. And although NICE say that there is no single diagnostic test, they do say that they recommend, if there's any sort of diagnostic uncertainty, that they recommend pheno testing. A peak flow diary is very helpful, but the issue is that it relies a lot on patient compliance, and sometimes that might not be ideal. And so it doesn't make it the most objective measure, but it can be really helpful for revealing patterns. For example, if it was a strictly Monday to Friday thing, for example, you might think it's linked to their occupation or their place of work. Other testing that can help is on a full blood count, you may see eosinophilia. But again, this is more on an acute exacerbation. And again, you can do a trial of treatment, which we'll talk about, and again, would be quite common after an exacerbation. But it's technically not an objective test. I'm not going to go through all the information on this slide, but you're welcome to screenshot this. But as I said, this will go on YouTube afterwards. The main things I wanted to point out is, in terms of looking at reversibility, this is indicated by a 12% improvement in the peak flow, which is a positive result. And if there's an improvement of more than 400 milliliters on peak flow testing, that's very strongly suggestive of asthma. And we'll talk about some restrictive and some obstructive conditions throughout this talk. So next question. To answer some of the questions in the chat, primary care can arrange for a pheno testing, but it would likely be done in a hospital. And regarding whether you won't be tested beyond the third step, no, you still could be tested. But as I said, they would specify if there's any ambiguity. Stop all there. So majority of people were correct. And here we're going to go through the severity grading of an acute asthma exacerbation. So we have moderate, severe, life-threatening, and then near fatal. And again, some of the main points that I want to point out here are, sort of, for moderate, you're looking at peak flow 50 to 75%. For severe acute asthma, you're looking for more systemic signs, so things like tachycardia, an objective tachypnea, and also then you're looking at lower peak flow. When you're thinking life-threatening, you want to look at hypoxia and also a normal carbon dioxide, because that suggests that they're not clearing carbon dioxide as well. And so as a result, it's coming up, because if someone was having an asthma attack, you would expect them to be tachypnea, which would result in a lower CO2. So if it's higher or normal, that's very worrying. And as that previous question demonstrated, if it's higher, that's suggestive of near fatal asthma exacerbation. The recording for the seminar will go on our YouTube channel, which is, if you type in QuesMed or QuesMed tutorials on YouTube, you'll be able to find the channel. So again, majority got this one correct. And now we're going to talk about sort of discharge planning and what happens once an acute exacerbation has been treated. So again, key point here is that the peak flow needs to be more than or equal to 75% of their predicted, which you can find calculators online to do this, or their best, which may have been documented if they've got known asthma in previous respiratory clinic letters. They need to be off of their nebulizers for and be stable on their inhalers for 24 hours. And normally what happens in practice is an asthma nurse or a respiratory nurse will come and review the inhaler technique as well as their compliance. And they'll take home a written management plan, which will be on the next slide, which has, which is really helpful for patients to know sort of when they need to come in, when they might be experiencing exacerbation. Sometimes the exacerbation may have been treated within a few days, so they may still have some of their steroid course to complete. And again, these are ideal and these are targets in practice. It's very difficult, but they should have a GP review within 48 hours. And if they're known to a respiratory clinic, they should be seen within a month. And if they go to ITU, they need lifelong respiratory follow-up. And this is an example of an asthma plan. And these things do happen in practice. It reminds me of when I was working in A&E and there was a thunderstorm last summer and there were so many patients coming in with asthma. One of the cubicles was using almost as a salbutamol nebulizer hot box where patients were just coming in, having their nebulizers, and then they were having their peak flow checked afterwards. So these things definitely do happen. They do make a difference and they are very helpful in practice. And now we have the next question. So if they haven't returned to their baseline in 1 hour, sometimes they'll have another nebulizer and then have it rechecked afterwards, essentially. Okay, I don't think we need to have this one up too long. So yeah, smoking cessation, absolutely. The key in the question is, because some people have gone for A, is that the question asks about improving prognosis, and an ipratropium bromide inhaler would be more important for an acute flare rather than something that's prognostic. You know, the answer, if anything to do with prognosis or pretty much anything, if there's an option that says smoking cessation, go for it. And no, that's a terrible joke about ulcerative colitis. But yes, it's always smoking cessation. And again, you'll see this in practice as well. It's a really important point to hammer home when you see these patients, as we'll see in some of the future questions as well. So to go over COPD, extremely common. Lots of people smoke. Lots of people smoke for a long time. Lots of people have been smoking for a long time. And again, this is obstructive. It's similar to asthma in that sense. However, there is little to no reversibility, as we have mentioned. And, you know, if someone continues smoking, that damage is only going to get worse. Patients tend to be older and they'll have a chronic shortness of breath rather than these sort of frequent acute flares like you might get in asthma. And they're more likely to have a productive cough. And again, different from asthma in that there won't be a diurnal or seasonal variation. We went through some basic spirometry earlier, and the FEV one is best for determining the severity, and we use the gold grading for that. And on a chest x-ray, you may see signs such as hyperventilated lung fields, as well as complications. And again, that obviously increases your risk of developing malignancy later, which can also appear on chest imaging. This session will hopefully be about an hour, planning to end at 7 o'clock. Sarah? I'm going to stop the poll there. I'm actually stopping the polls a bit early because you guys are doing really well and answering questions really quickly. If anyone feels though that I'm ending them too early, please do mention in the chat. And again, the key here is we know that they're a retainer, but again, in practice, if someone was severely hypoxic, they're going to be started on high flow oxygen straight away. ATE always, hypoxia kills. In this sense, they're not severely hypoxic, and we do know that he is a retainer, so going for a venturi is the correct answer. Nasal cannula is not going to do much here. Neither is a simple face mask. And they don't currently meet thresholds for NIV or non-invasive ventilation. Again, to go through quickly, acute COPD exacerbations. For some who are known retainers, they may chronically operate at saturations of around 88%. So if you do see that straight away, it's not always a cause for concern. And of course, there is a risk with over-oxygenating in these situations. Again, really key investigations here are going to be an ABG, which, you know, should always use local anesthetic for. And that will give you very important information that will influence your further treatment, especially in the acute phase. And if it shows that they're not chronically retaining, then, you know, by all means, go for 15 liters and you don't have to worry about the potential complications. Now we've got the next question. I'm going to give a bit longer because there's quite a bit to read here. I appreciate. So again, majority of people got that correct. This patient is someone who meets criteria for LTOT or long-term oxygen therapy. And again, can't emphasize strongly enough, you cannot smoke if you want to be considered for long-term oxygen therapy. If someone is a smoker and they've got a big canister of oxygen at home, that's not a good recipe. There's a very high mortality rate there. So for patients to be eligible for long-term oxygen therapy, you know, as I said, can't smoke. And then we use ABGs, serial ABGs, at least 3 months apart. And on two occasions where you look for chronic hypoxia, or if they don't meet that threshold, if their oxygen is less than 8, but they have complications such as the 4 listed on screen, that can be another indication. They just have to have one of those, not all 4 of them. And I would say quite common ones that are seen in practice are secondary polycythemia and the peripheral edema. But actually, now that I think about it, having worked on the respiratory ward, actually, I've seen all 4 of those. And also in terminally ill patients for comfort, for palliative management. But again, even if they're terminally ill, they still have to be non-smokers. Do you have to prove your non-smoking status? No, you have to trust the patient, and you tell them that if they smoke with a big amount of oxygen at home, they may lose their home because it will blow up. And again, that ideally that, you know, there shouldn't be any smokers either, because you don't want to put any naked flame near high concentrated oxygen. I'm not going to spend too much time on ABGs because you probably covered this in depth at medical school, but, you know, main things, are they acidotic or alkalotic at the start? And then you want to look at their carbon dioxide, and then their bicarb, and then lastly their oxygen. And as a general rule of thumb, the FiO2 minus 10 can give you a brief indicator of, again, how actually hypoxic they may be relative to how much oxygen they're receiving. So if they're on a 40% venturi, you'd expect their PaO2 to be around 30. So if it was less than that, that actually indicates that someone's got quite a potentially significant hypoxia because they're not utilizing the amount of oxygen they're being given. And then at the top, there's just a mnemonic that might help you remember. Okay, we're getting a bit of a split here, but let's go through it. So the answer here is B, so in ICU. And we're going to talk about pneumonia now. And I thought I'd start off with a good medical meme. So severity scoring and pneumonia. So we use the CURB-65 or the CRB-65 in primary care because blood tests may not be immediately available. The main parts of that are confusion, urea, respiratory rate, blood pressure, and the age. And if their scoring is zero, they're safe to manage in the community and probably don't need antibiotics. If it's a one, and they're not hypoxic, because again, as I said, hypoxia kills, ATE first always. They're safe to manage in the community and they'll normally receive oral antibiotics. If they're scoring a two or above, they need to be in hospital. And that normally means that they need to receive intravenous antibiotics because if they could be treated orally, there isn't much of an indication for them to be at hospital unless there's other signs that they're septic, for example. If they're scoring a three or above, you were thinking ITU and thinking, you know, this is someone who's going to need advanced management, because the whole point of the scoring system is it's for prognosis, and those that score above two have a high mortality. And in terms of antimicrobial choice and antimicrobial stewardship, again, this will very much depend on your local guidelines. If you haven't downloaded MicroGuide already, I would strongly advise it. It's really helpful when you're on placement. But generally, what we're using in the community tends to be amoxicillin or clarithromycin. In hospital, if they're receiving IV antibiotics, it's normally Coamox and clarithromycin. But again, it very much determines on your trust. The trust I was working in commonly gave oral doxycycline as first line for community-acquired pneumonia. And again, if you're suspecting, if it's an aspiration pneumonia, for example, you might put in metronidazole to cover for anaerobes. So again, it can vary. And again, I've included a few things on allergy here. It's always important to determine just how, if someone has a true allergy or an intolerance. Obviously, if someone's describing a previous anaphylactic reaction, then you're not going to take a risk. But if someone just has a bit of diarrhea, it's less strong of a case for quantifying an allergy. And again, just another point on antimicrobial stewardship. So when in doubt, when it comes to your OSCEs, again, you can, if you're doing an ATE scenario and it is pneumonia, you can say, you know, I would give this, but I would refer to local guidelines. The app is called MicroGuide. Okay, I don't think we need to spend much more time on this one, as pretty much everyone's got it correct. It's chest X-ray pneumonia. by definition is actually a radiological diagnosis. That means that there is consolidation on chest imaging, normally chest x-ray. And to be honest, this question's a bit iffy because, again, in practice, this doesn't necessarily happen all the time. So whether it must be done is a bit questionable, but quite often there will be a chest x-ray done 4 to 6 weeks later to see if there's been resolution of the pneumonia. So again, majority got this one right. What I will say is there is a slight split here. And if anyone's coming in with chest pain and tachycardia and it's pleuritic, you've got to consider a pulmonary embolism. It's an extremely important differential with a very high mortality and something that you can't miss. That said, the question asks for the most likely diagnosis. And based on the fact that they have a significant smoking history as well and their age as well, these sort of point towards a pneumothorax, and they don't have any other additional risk factors, for example, a long haul flight or an active malignancy that would point towards a P. And we'll go through well scoring and testing for P later. But yes, this patient most likely has a pneumothorax. Okay, we've got a bit of a split here. And the answer is pleural aspiration. So this is someone where we know the diagnosis is a pneumothorax. They've had a chest x-ray. It shows that it's a 2 centimeter pneumothorax. There's no tracheal deviation and observations are normal. So some of you have gone for D. We're not worried about a tension pneumothorax here. They've got normal observations, there's no tracheal deviation. So there's no indication for that. We've then got admitting for 24 hours observation, we've got fitting a chest drain, pleural aspiration. I'm shortly going to go on to the updated BTS guidelines for pneumothorax, which were updated very recently, towards the end of 2023. And they mention a few very important caveats, taking into account things like the local hospital services available, and the patient, preferences for treatment as well. So the first thing is the fact that the pneumothorax is 2 centimeters, they define as being amenable to an intervention. So that's one thing to consider. If the pneumothorax was 1.5 centimeters, then we're not going to intervene. The next thing, in the first instance, because this patient is saying that he is keen for interventions and he wants what will resolve the symptoms the quickest, that's the key in differentiating between the pleural aspiration and the admission for observation. An aspiration will resolve the symptoms the quickest, and he has no objections to that intervention. Now, if his symptoms were to continue following aspiration, then we can see from this diagram that he would be eligible for a chest drain. And instead of previously where they used to talk about whether it's a primary or a secondary pneumothorax, the key now here are high risk characteristics. So there's any hemodynamic compromise, if there's significant hypoxia, there's a bilateral pneumothoraces, which is more common in patients with known emphysema. There's an underlying lung disease, so that's that secondary aspect, and their age, and also if there's a hemopneumothorax, which is more common in stab victims, for example. And again, because of these caveats, I would think that if you're going to get a finals question on this, that they would have to include these kinds of details, like if the patient is keen for interventions, for example. Or for example, I think a good way to differentiate, if I was writing an SBA and I wanted to differentiate, I might say that patient is needle phobic, for example, as a way to sort of demonstrate that they're not really keen for aspirations or chest drains even. And again, if there's, in terms of conservative management, that very much depends on the services available. So I think that's a bit trickier to ask about personally, because you'll see that on placement as well. But I'd strongly recommend checking out this flowchart. It's very helpful and learning that. And no, that guidance on the previous page was for tension pneumothorax and a non-tension pneumothorax. Okay, so majority going with the right answer here. So this is someone with a pleural effusion. And again, this is, we already done a chest x-ray to show that it's there. So repeating that at this point in time will not be helpful. They may have a repeat chest x-ray to see if there's been resolution of it and to check if, you know, if a chest drain is inserted later down the line to check the position of it, but not relevant now. CT scans are sometimes used in pleural fusions, especially if you think there's a particularly exotic cause of it, or if it's not responding to treatment, because a CT scan can show, for example, if there's any evidence of loculation, which means it's a bit more complicated. It's not a simple effusion, but that's not indicated here. And we've got BNP, which if someone had a pleural effusion that we thought was due to heart failure, for example, that might be more helpful, and amylase is not relevant here at all. So as the name suggests, fluid in the pleural space. On chest x-ray, this is indicated by costophrenic angle blunting, as well as you can often see a fluid level or menisci, which we can see here. If there's a massive pleural effusion, which I don't have an image of, and there's a complete whiteout, the trachea will be pushed away from the effusion. And on examination, as in that previous vignette, you'll see signs such as reduced expansion on the effective side, decreased breath sounds, and also dullness to percussion. And in terms of differentiating the different kinds of causes, we generally split them into transudative causes and exudative causes. And on aspiration, there'll be a panel of investigations that you'll do along with that, which was obviously the answer on the previous question, looking at things like your protein, your LDH, and sometimes you check for things like TB, for example. And you want to check the lactate and the glucose as well. And aspiration is therefore both diagnostic and therapeutic, because it can help you with what the cause is, but it will also help relieve the symptoms. But if it is a particularly big effusion, then they're likely to need a drain. But obviously things like this can also help you find out what microorganism is causing the pleural effusion, and that will also guide your antimicrobial choice. So going through lights criteria, this is when we have that sort of gray area between the protein level that we saw on the previous slide. And essentially using this will help you determine the cause of it. So with the exudative causes, the main causes are infection and malignancy, but also sort of any condition which causes an increase in inflammation can cause this. So things like rheumatoid arthritis, SLE can cause this as well, and also PE. In terms of transudative causes, I think of it as the failures. So cardiac failure, renal failure, hepatic or liver failure are the main causes. But you can also get renal causes. So from nephrotic syndrome, if you're leaking proteins, and also from MIBE syndrome, which is a triad. So what we have here is 30-year-old coming to A&E with pleuritic chest pain. He's recently come back from New Zealand. Maybe he went to work in New Zealand as a doctor for a bit and then come back for a holiday. He's tachycardic, he's tachypneic, he's hypoxic. His blood pressure is quite low. He's hemodynamically unstable, and he's already had a CTPA as well as a bedside echo. And that CTPA shows a filling defect in the pulmonary artery, and that echo showing raised right heart pressures. Now, that filling defect suggests that there's something blocking blood flow, i.e. a pulmonary embolism. And because of that hemodynamic instability and the echo results, those are red flags, which suggest that this may be a massive PE. And in these cases, prompt thrombolysis treatment needs to be recommended. D-dimer is not going to be helpful here. DOAC, if they didn't have red flag signs, DOAC would be correct. Doesn't need a repeat CTPA, and we wouldn't give prophylactic low molecular weight heparin. So again, going through PE management. So obviously A to E, they need high flow oxygen if they're hypoxic. If they're in pain, give them analgesia. If they're hemodynamically stable, we can either confirm the diagnosis with a CTPA if you can get that done within 4 hours. But if not, they should be started on treatment for a PE in the meantime if there's a high suspicion of it. Because obviously, if there is a PE, that will start the treatment process, because we don't want to delay treatment for a PE because, again, it has a high mortality. If, however, they're hemodynamically unstable, as often indicated by their blood pressure and their heart rate, you want to give thrombolytic treatment, most commonly with alteplase. Again, that can be trust-specific, though. That's the acute management. In terms of the long-term management, it very much depends on the cause. So if it's a provoked cause, as in this case, he had risk factors such as a long-haul flight, but other provoked causes can be surgery, especially if there's a period of immobility, and also in the peripartum stage, they only require treatment for 3 months. But if it's unprovoked, they need to be on treatment for at least 6 months. And if someone's having an unprovoked PE, again, as I've seen as working during my foundation training, that rings alarm bells for if there's a malignancy, because a malignancy will significantly increase your risk of having a PE. And most of these patients will go on to have often a CT, thorax, abdomen, and pelvis while they're an inpatient to look for potential malignant causes. And again, if it's provoked, but it's ongoing, so if there's a thrombophilia, for example, or if they've got antiphospholipid syndrome, then they're often on lifelong anticoagulation. This is the well scoring, which I'm sure you're very familiar with, which goes through sort of risk factors for PE. And essentially, if the scoring is more than 4 and a PE is likely, we'll go for a CTPA. But again, as I said, if we're unable to arrange that within 4 hours, they should be commenced on treatment for it. It's as per NICE guidelines. And again, DOACs are favored now over either low molecular weight heparin, for example, or warfarin. If the PE is less, if the well score is less than 4, however, a D dimer is recommended. And here's some more about stats and PE. So with a D-dimer, it's got a great negative predictive value. So if someone's got a very low D-dimer, they're very unlikely to have a PE. The issue with it is that it's got poor specificity. So anything that causes inflammation will cause a raised D-dimer, essentially, because it's an acute inflammatory product. So if someone's got a pneumonia, for example, they might have a raised D-dimer. If someone's pregnant, they're going to have a raised D-dimer. That's why, actually, you know, if someone's got a high risk for it, you should be going for a CTPA. That's the gold standard. And if a question's asking for the definitive investigation, that's what you would choose. And as we saw in that question stem before, what you're looking for are filling defects. And this has a very high specificity and a good positive predictive value. Some of the cons of it, obviously, is not everyone, you know, we can't CTPA everyone, because also that's a big radiation dose and that isn't safe. And also, unfortunately, you know, we don't have the resources for that in most hospitals. And again, this is just the flow chart sort of demonstrating sort of the pathways we go down. I'm just going to have a quick look at some of the questions now. Is the PESI score always calculated? Yes, the PESI score pretty much always is calculated. As I said, I've worked in both A&E and on a respiratory ward, and in A&E, I pretty much always did the PESI score. In respiratory, obviously, it's you're kind of out of the acute phase, so they may have already had that measured. But definitely in the acute phase, yes. The red flag symptoms we've already mentioned, so the main things were the if there's any evidence of right heart strain and if there's hemodynamic instability. And in terms of the well scoring, I would recommend revising it. Unfortunately, I think it's a bit arbitrary because in practice, you know, I use MD Calc, I use calculator, but unfortunately, finals questions do test for it. So that's one of the things you do just kind of have to learn. And in terms of the PESI score, that's something used to risk stratify and to measure the potential severity of a PE. And that can help also determine the type of treatment that you start. And then the PERC is used for ruling out the PE. So yes, they do use the PERC as well. I apologize if I'm using a lot of abbreviations that not everyone may understand, but I would advise sort of looking them up in your own time because we still have quite a bit to get through. But really good questions, really good thoughts. And yes, the slides won't be available, but the recording will be on YouTube afterwards. It's quite a tricky one, so I'm just going to give a little bit more time before we go through it. Okay, we'll end it there. So some of you may be unhappy because there's quite a spread here, but let's look at this question. Let's break it down. And also, you know, if you'd seen one of the other QuesMed videos that I've done on YouTube, you would have already seen this question and might have known the answer to it. But let's break it down. So we've got an elderly man with a significant smoking history. They've had some weight loss, a persistent cough, and occasionally they're describing hemoptysis. They're also getting night sweats. And these are legit night sweats, not like sweating at night. This is someone who's needing to change their bed sheets. So I think that's already enough red flag symptoms to think that this might be someone who's got a malignancy going on, probably a lung malignancy. They're more thirsty and they're also passing more urine than usual. And they're also constipated. These are sort of signs and symptoms of hypercalcemia. And they're also, you know, we've got a bit of clubbing here, and they're also a bit confused. So this is a complication of a lung malignancy, and that complication is HPOA. So squamous cell carcinoma is a type of lung cancer. We're going to talk about lung malignancies now, if that wasn't clear. Is most commonly associated with smoking, and is a very common lung cancer, not the commonest in the UK, though, however. And again, one of the important features here, which can help you sort of differentiate in your exam questions, is that you tend to get quite local spread of it, and you'll often have metastasis quite late. In terms of what we saw in the stem above, there was signs and symptoms of hypercalcemia, and other associations are, again, with HPOA and clubbing, which I know clubbing isn't necessarily the most specific sign, because you see in lots of malignancies, but there's a particularly strong association here. This next slide is quite busy. I'm not going to go through all of it. And, you know, as I said, you might want to screenshot this, for example, but sort of go through the main other lung malignancies. So adenocarcinoma, which is the most common, arises from mucous cells. And again, it most commonly spreads to the brain and the bones. And it's more common in non-smokers, actually. And it's also very likely to cause pleural effusions as well. So when we were talking about pleural effusions related to malignancy, this is one of the common offenders. And then we've also got small cell carcinoma, which comes from endocrine cells. And small cell carcinoma spreads very early, actually, and very commonly to the brain. And for that reason, and I believe this is still the case, patients diagnosed with small cell carcinomas tend to actually have brain radiotherapy very early on. Although it's very responsive to chemotherapy, as they found lots of new sort of monoclonal antibody treatments for it, generally the prognosis is still quite poor, and that's because of the propensity to spread very early on. In terms of paraneoplastic syndromes that we get in lung cancer, if we break them up by system, so we've got neurological ones, so we've got polyneuropathies and Lambert-Eaton syndrome are probably the main ones. Lambert-Eaton syndrome, it presents very similarly to myasthenia gravis, but key differentiators here on investigations, you want to look for antibodies to voltage-gated calcium channels. Vascular complications, we've got thrombophlebitis migrans, and also obviously anemia is very common in malignancy. We've talked about HPOA, somewhat niche. If you see an onion skin, think of that. Very common, we talked about finger clubbing already, carcinoid syndrome. So that often, I believe, is due to an increase in serotonin, and that presents with an enlarged liver, flushing, and diarrhea. Lots of people went for SIADH with the one of the options before, and we can get that in certain lung cancers. And another paraneoplastic syndrome we can also get is Cushing syndrome, and that's to do with ectopic ACTH secretion. So that whole negative feedback loop eventually isn't functioning, because you're just getting constant ACTH secretion, which won't respond to any negative feedback, at least so long as the malignancy is there. So someone's asked about TB. I appreciate that there were sort of some risk factors for it, but the, for example, the significant smoking history and the weight loss, which again, you can get a bit with both, but I'd say the smoking history in particular is sort of the main thing that's sort of driving you towards a malignancy rather than TB. And yes, technically any type of lung cancer can have paraneoplastic syndromes. Oh, and actually that's the end. So thank you so much for attending the seminar. I hope you found it useful. I hope that there were some learning points for you from that. If you can fill out the feedback by scanning this QR code, I'd really appreciate it. We've got 7 more lectures coming up, so if there's anything that we can sort of act on that you suggest, you know, we're very open to hearing that. And I'm going to be giving a few more lectures myself, so if you've got any points for me to improve, I won't take any offense to it, genuinely. I read a lot of the emails you guys send in, so I'm used to receiving the criticism on our platform anyway. I also want to plug a podcast that we've started recently called Quezcast. Particularly if you're a final year medical student, I think you might find this interesting, where we talk about managing complex cases. So that's on our YouTube channel, Quezmed Tutorials. And as I said, this session is being recorded and I will upload it hopefully quite soon afterwards. Keep a lookout on the social media platforms for when the next lectures are and how to register for them, either on Instagram or Facebook. And if you have any questions, you can always email those in. I monitor the email account. So if there's anything for me that comes my way, I'm more than happy to sort of address that. And yeah, again, like I said, I'd really appreciate the if you could fill out the feedback forms, just because it helps us. And I'll stop the recording there.